Bless the Lord, O my soul.
Yes.
And all that is within me. Praises. Bless his name. We want to thank those of you who have come back out eating all the chicken and all the collard greens and drinking all the red Kool-Aid. You know that is a sleep potion. We want to thank God for allowing you and us all to come back safely and ready to give God praise. The Bible says in Lamentations around chapter 3, verse 22, that it is of the Lord's mercies that we are not consumed. It is because of his mercies. And I like that because there's a S on mercy. It'd be one thing to say because of your mercy, but he says because of your mercies with an S. That we are not consumed. And so every day we ought to give God praise, but especially when we come in corporate expression, which is the Lord's church. I want to thank each and every one of you, and in particular the elders and the deacons of this fine congregation where I've been a member for about 30 years. I have grown up from a little snotty-nosed preteen to a big snotty-nosed. I want to thank God and thank you. Thank so many people in this congregation who have been sort of like surrogate mothers and fathers, who have been supportive, who have been prayerful for me. You know, the road has not always been smooth, but that's part of life. It's good that you can go through things so that you can live and tell about it. You can help somebody else who may be going through the same situation. I want to thank Brother Wilson, Brother Johnson, so many other deacons and elders, Floyd, and so many other people here. Members here, I tell you, always give them hugs, encouragement. And then also, I want to thank Brother Hayward, who I consider not only a friend, but a man who has mentored me, who has spent time with me, hours, helping me to grow and to develop the little gift that I have. He has told me to keep studying, keep praying, and keep proclaiming God's word, and that is what I want to do. And as that song said, I love to praise him. I don't know about you, but I love to praise him. I don't have a problem praising Christ. As a matter of fact, I had a chance to visit my old congregation about 2 weeks ago. And when you look at people who you love, who you see in their eyes and they love God, but they don't have a clue when it comes to salvation. But then when you come to God's people and they act like they don't have a clue, they don't understand the gift. I believe in Colossians chapter 1, around verse 13, he says, he has delivered us from the kingdom of darkness and translated us. Now, that word in the Greek means it's a monetary meaning. It means to exchange one from the other. See, you have been translated and you don't act like it. You have been bought, but you don't act like it. Praise God, I should be happy every day that I didn't press it. Dying pillow and smell fire afterwards. But I'm so thankful that God has blessed us and blessed all of us to have the opportunity to hear the truth and to obey the truth before it's everlasting too late. Amen. I want you to turn your Bibles. I'm not going to keep you very long. 15 to 20 minutes is basically what I'm going to just use to give you a message and hope that will encourage you along this pilgrim pathway. I want you to turn to Exodus as was read in the hearing. We will read again for emphasis' sake. Exodus chapter 16, and we'll begin at verse number 1. We'll terminate at verse number 4. The Bible reads, and they took their journey from Elim, and all the congregation of the children of Israel came unto the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month, after their departing out of the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said unto them, would to God we had died in the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread too full. For you have brought us out forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Then said the Lord unto Moses, Behold, I will rain bread from heaven for you, and the people shall go out and gather a certain grain every day, that I might prove them whether they will walk in my law or not. This morning, or this afternoon rather, I want to talk about one day at a time. One day at a time. And just for a subtopic, I want to add, learning how to trust him when you can't trace him. Learning how to trust him when you can't trace him. As I said, I won't be long, but I want to hit three major points and then the lesson will be yours. I want to first show how the children of Israel commended God. Secondly, I want to show how the children of Israel complained about God. But then lastly, I want to show how God cared for his people. In chapter 15, I want you to notice something very strange. The children of Israel have just come from their Red Sea experience. They have been cornered between a rock and a hard place. They are at the edge of the Red Sea, and there is no swimming across. But as they turn and look, they see hundreds, if not thousands, of Pharaoh's army closing in behind them. And they look at Moses, and they start to say, Moses, why did you bring us out here to die? We were doing fine eating Pharaoh's bread. We were doing fine working overtime. We were doing okay making minimum wage. We only got fed on Monday and beat on Tuesday. What was wrong with that? But now you have brought us to the brink of death. Why did you do that, Moses? Moses says something in verse 14 that still gives me chills. Moses hears the complaining. Moses just thinks to himself, and in verse 11 of chapter 14, they say these things. But then Moses says in verse 13, Fear not, stand still, and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will show you today. And so when I see that, I take courage because you know the story. The Red Sea is split, the children of Israel walk on dry land, and then God does something very strategic. He sends a cloud to lead them through the Red Sea. But then he goes behind them to make a dark cloud to confuse the enemy. Y'all don't see that. He goes ahead of them to lead them to the crossing of the Red Sea. He's light to his people, but he's darkness to everybody else. That's metaphorically the way it is in the world. That the preaching of the cross is foolishness to them that perish. But to us, see, we've got the light and we're too scared to let it shine. Israel crosses over, and as they get to the other side, in chapter 15, verses 1 all the way down to verse 21, look at some of the things they say. Verse 1 says, Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider have thrown into the sea. Look at verse 2. Then the Lord is my strength and song, and he has become my salvation. He is my God, and I will prepare for him a habitation. My father's God, and I will exalt him. The Lord is a man of war. The Lord is his name. Pharaoh's chariots and his hosts have he cast into the sea. His chosen captains also are drowned in the Red Sea. The depths have covered them. They sank into the bottom as a stone. They've given God praise. They love the Lord for the victory. Look at verse 13. Thou in thy mercy hast led forth the people which thou hast redeemed. Thou hast guided them in the strength unto the holy habitation. They are just having a hallelujah good time. And well, they should. I believe God's people, when they realize what they have been delivered from, should give God some praise. I don't know about you, but I think that God's people, if anybody should shout, if anybody should get up, and if anybody should say something, it should be God's people. But for some strange reason, we don't feel that inside. We have to feign excitement sometimes. But I just serve a God that when I think back on my life, when I think back about where I could have been, the places my life could have ended, I think to myself, I'm just living on borrowed time. I don't know about you, but I really do. I can remember so many times in my personal life where I should have been either in the hospital, paralyzed, or just plain dead. And I thank God. I thank God. I know some of y'all have had your own experiences. And I know sometimes when you're sitting there, you know, you may not want to express that, but I want you to know that we should give God some praise for what he's done. As they go on through chapter 15, even Miriam gets in the act. Miriam is Moses' sister. And she begins to praise God. And they begin to get happy. And then in around verse 25, they come out from the Red Sea, the borders of East Egypt. They're walking across this land called Shur. Shur is a place where they've never been before. It's a desert place. It's a wilderness. Now, I don't want you to confuse the word wilderness with our wilderness. When you think of wilderness in our particular contemporary context, you're thinking about trees and squirrels and rabbits and that kind of thing. Now, this is the Middle East. And so they're coming out of Egypt and they're going towards Canaan's land. But as they go towards Canaan land, they have to go through some wilderness. And they've got to go through dry places. And now here it is, just 3 days later, from Sunday morning service. Now we're at Wednesday afternoon. Boss is in the office. Get a call 5 times. The kids are told to put the top back on the toothpaste. They still leaving it off. The husband is still leaving the lid up on the toilet. Things like this getting on your nerve, and you want to say some things. You want to speak in some tongues, but it sounds like English. You know, you want to use four-letter words that ain't Mark, Luke, Acts, and John. But you got to realize that you were just 3 days removed from giving them some praise. And that same God that helped you get over the Red Sea is that same God that's in Shur right now. As they walk through Shur, they come to a place called Mara. They are thirsty, and they begin to look at Moses and say, "Moses, Moses, I know God delivered me from the Egyptians, and I know that you've been good on your word, but look, man, this is desert. Now, ain't no water out here. You promised us water, man. We got 2 million people about to die. We are more than parched. We need water, Moses." You know, Moses, then they show their ethnicity. Moses. Moses, can you listen to me, Moses? Moses, are you there? Moses. We need water. They cried out. But the thing I like about the Bible is it says that when they cried out, they didn't cry out to Moses. They didn't murmur against Moses. Because, see, in Moses' position, all he was the messenger. That's all he was. Moses was just like you and me, any other person. But it was God behind Moses. That was a representative. And so when they complained to Moses, they were actually complaining about God. God, how you going to bring us through the Red Sea, and now we 3 days and we about to die? I don't understand that. That don't make no sense. That's the attitude. That's the attitude. Because they didn't have faith. They didn't have belief that the same God that brought them from there can bring them out of there into somewhere else. But then to add insult to injury, when they get to a place where they've got water, the Bible says the water is bitter. Can you imagine that? Can you imagine getting removed from a bad place in your life only to find a new reality is unpleasant? Has anybody ever experienced that? You've been begging, Lord, if you can just give me another job. Oh, mercy. Kill somebody up in here. You got to move on. And then you get the new job and you got a new set of problems. It's the same thing, just a different face. But that's the reality. God has moved them from desert, but now they're in Mara. They're in a place where they have a spring, a small source of water. And the water is bitter. And so God tells Moses, take a tree, put it in the water. Moses does what God says, and all of a sudden the bitter water turns sweet. And see, that's what I like about God. God can take a bitter situation that you're in. He doesn't have to take you somewhere else. But he can make your situation currently sweeter. But you got to trust in God. You've got to give your all to him where you're at. It doesn't matter how bad your situation might be. Give it to God. Let God work that thing out. He can turn that bitter situation, that bitter marriage, that bitter relationship, that bitter job. He can change that into something sweet. But he wants you to stay the course. Some of y'all are asking, why haven't I got a new position? It's because God ain't ready for you to move. God needs you there for some reason. He wants you to be a salt in the middle of that situation. Some of us want to move, but God has an assignment for us. My assignment is not your assignment. Have you ever thought about that? Perhaps you need to stay on that job and that supervisor is looking at you and wondering, how does he take it? I just don't see it. I can tell you a personal story. I'm on a job currently. This is recorded. Anytime something is recorded, you got to be real careful. But I recall some prayers. My Lord, can you just move me out of the situation? Can you just Lord, please? And it didn't get any better. Marcus, I was still frustrated. Come home, head hurt. You know. Meanwhile, my co-workers are doing whatever they want to do. I'm working like a Hebrew slave has been put on 90-day punishment. And I'm not getting anywhere. But I would then begin to do like David and start praying imprecatory prayers. That's just a fancy word for prayers to put curses on people. You know what I mean? Oh, thank God, God, amen. But you can just give them a flat tire. Or it's icy today. It would look like anything happened if he hurt his leg. I'm serious. And I'll never forget, this is about maybe four or five years ago, I was teaching a class in this very auditorium on forgiveness. And I was talking about how in Matthew 5 it talks about pray for them that despitefully use you. You know, I'm going on and I'm like, man, can you just imagine somebody is constantly at you and you got to pray for them? And mad people, hey man, Brother Clark, I really appreciate the lesson. I said, yeah, I appreciate it too. That next Monday, I come to work, before I can walk in the door, oh Lord, I got to deal with this. Lord, I got to deal with this man. Lord, please. You know, but it was because God had to mature me. Yeah. This is the God on the street. What I did was, I said to myself, I had a conversation, sometimes you got to talk to yourself.
Yeah.
I said, self, I said, now listen to this. So you just preached this situation yesterday.
All right.
Pray for them.
Amen.
Ah, Lord, I can't do it. I tried. I can't do it, Lord. Try it again. Lord, please bless him that he may have long life. I can't do it. Do it again.
Right.
Point is, I kept doing it. After a while, I prayed for this man.
Amen.
Do you not know about a week later, he called me in his office. And I just thought, I'm going to get my weekly chew out. You know, I'm just praying that I don't say nothing back. That I don't have to come up here and say I have sinned. Right? So I get up there and I say, yes, sir, how can I help you? He's like, you know, you didn't get your raise last year, but we have been reviewing you. You've been doing pretty good, so we're going to give you a raise.
Amen.
In about another month passed, they called me in the office again. I'm like, oh, what I do this time? He says, there is also another bonus that you're entitled for. Two raises in less than 2 months.
Right.
Now, that's not even about the money per se.
No.
But he had another situation. I'll never forget. I was coming into work. He was leaving. And he said, I said, you okay?
for some reason, I just felt the urge to ask him what was wrong. He said, yeah, I'm doing okay. I won't be in for a couple of days this morning, you know. And I said, okay. I said, well, you know, whatever it is, I hope it works out. He said, yeah, my Ryan said, I haven't told anybody this, but my wife is sick. And I said, well, okay, I'll be praying for her. I said, what's her name? He gave her a name, and I prayed for her. I think it was about 3 or 4 weeks after that, he called me. And he said, I haven't told anybody this. He said, but my wife, she was in a coma. And she spoke for the first time in 3 years. Now, I'm not taking credit for that. But what I'm simply saying is that he recognized, yes, the child of God,
yes,
that he tried to get rid of multiple times.
Yes. Yes.
That he caused my life to be pure to heaven. But because God didn't remove me from that situation, God used me,
amen,
as an agent to show them what a Christian should do.
Amen.
And I want y'all to understand that. I want y'all to understand that because you don't know why God has you where he has you. Let's move on. I'm going to hasten on. In Exodus chapter 15, verse 27, they leave the shorelines of Egypt, cross over the Red Sea. Now they're in a place called Elam. Elam is a beautiful place. The Bible says there are 12 whales in Egypt. Elam, rather. Then it says there are 70 palm trees. Now, this is a picturesque place. I want you to get in your mind. Many of us right now wish we could take a vacation. No. What would be the first place you'd go? To Alaska? Antarctica? Anybody? Norway? South Pole? North Pole? No, no, no. You probably want to go to Cozumel, Florida, Sandestin. Some place that has palm trees. Some place that's nice and warm and the climate is more conducive to relaxing. This is the picture we see here. 12 wells representing the 12 tribes of Israel, meaning that there was an abundance. It's not just a small spring that that 2 million people got a drink from. This is abundance. See, God takes them from the Red Sea all the way through sin to Mara. Now he's got them in Elam. Do you see that progression?
Yeah.
See, in your life, you're not always going to have sunny days. The reason why I can appreciate the summer is because I've been through the winter. The reason why I can appreciate sunny days is because I've had a few rainy days. But if all your days are sunny, what you got to appreciate? That's why, you know, people that live in Florida, man, it's beautiful. I can stay here. I want 4 seasons in my life. Nothing against Floridians, but I personally don't like it. I want 4 seasons, okay? But I want you to see, when they come out, they come out of this place that's beautiful, Elam, and then they go into chapter 16. In chapter 16, there really starts the issue. Israel, again, is walking. They're about 45 days removed. The Bible says it's the 15th day of the second month. 45 days from the Red Sea experience. And now they're traveling through the land called Sin. And they're going through Shur. Now, Shur, ironically enough, in the Hebrew language means wall. And so when they come to this place, now they are really complaining. They've left the beautiful paradise, and they've got to travail on or traverse on, and now they've come to a place where it doesn't seem like anything is going right. It's Shur. They go from Red Sea to Shur defeat. But while they are remonstrating, God is renovating. I want you to hear that. While they are complaining and doing all that other stuff, God is working it out. See, right now in your life, you may be going through a period where you just feel like all I can do is, everything I do is just for naught. I'm working 2 jobs, I'm paying bills, and it looks like I get further in the hole. But God says, while you're doing that, while you're staying faithful, I'm working this thing out. See, I look back on my life, as short as it is, I look back on my life 20 years ago where I was then, compared to where I am now. See, I can give God praise. Because I remember when. So some of y'all can remember when. Y'all can think back further than me. Ain't that right, Brother Wilson? I mean, you can think about, you know, TVs with knobs and aluminum foil on the, you know. And I remember, you know, and then when I was the remote control, hey, turn that channel 46. 9, wrong stage. Go to 17. See, I don't know about all this fancy stuff. I was the remote control. Y'all remember fried bologna sandwiches, you know? Putting water in the ketchup bottle and making it. That's the kind of stuff we used to be. You know, I know some of y'all ain't gonna admit to that. Y'all ain't very rich either. You know, I used to ride the Marble when I was in school. Some of these kids got cars freshman year. I rode the bus so much I put an alarm on it. That's the bus driver pulled up and I wasn't thinking, oh, he coming. That's the kind of thing I've been through in my life. I don't know about y'all, but that's what you gotta go through. You gotta appreciate that. Bible says they were through Merah and they've gotten to this place called Shur. But then, as they complain, I can hear Joseph. When he went through his life's test, when he said, but as for you, you thought evil against me, but God meant it unto good to bring to pass, as it is this day, to save much people alive. You've got to look at your life and say, I don't know what the end result is, but I know it's going to work out for the good. I don't know how the story is going to end, but I know I'm winning in the end. You got to have that attitude. Like Charlie Sheen, still winning. Lost my job, still winning. Lost my baby, still winning. Lost the lotto, still winning. I saw some hands back there. Better stop that. As they go on, verse 26, God says, if you keep my commandments, He says, these diseases that I put on other people, I will not put on you. Look at that, verse 26. He says, if you do as I command, I won't put any of these diseases on. If you do what I command, I won't put any of these diseases. If you follow my command, I won't put any of these diseases. See, we're not talking about polio or cancer. We're talking about dis-ease. The prefix dis means without. The suffix ease literally means comfort. So you're going to be without comfort if you don't follow my command. Some of us are wondering why we are without comfort. It's because we're not following God's command. It's going to take time for us to sink in, but I hope before long, you guys will see where I'm going with this. Amen. God tells Israel the terms that he will provide. He will send the manna every morning. And then he says, if you, that's not good enough, boy, I'm going to send you quail every evening. But they are not to take more manna than it was required for that day. Look at Exodus chapter 16. This is roughly verses 11 through 28. But in particular, I want you to understand that in 16 to 29, God says, I'm going to feed them. They murmured against you, Moses, but they're murmuring against me. So what I'm going to do, I'm not going to kill them, but I'm going to feed them. I'm going to supply them. But this is what I want y'all to catch. God gives them manna. Some, the Bible says, get more. Others get less. Why is that? I figured if we're all the same, we should get the same amount of manna. But God says it depends on the household. You see what I'm saying? Brother McKinney's household may get a couple of omer of manna. You see what I'm saying? But then over here, Brother Howell's household may only get one cup of omer of manna. Back over there, some other brother and sister may get 10 cups of manna. And then over here, you might have another brother that only gets 3 or 4. See, it's not about how much you have. It's about, is God meeting your supply? See, in the church sometimes, we get the attitude that, you know what? How are you going to bless them, Lord, with that new 2012 Cadillac Escalade? And I've been coming to church faithfully. I'm still running around this 280Z. God, I don't understand how you bless Sister So-and-so to to live high on the hog out there in Alpharetta, but I still got to catch the bus over here in Riverdale. Well, we serve you the same way, don't we? I give as I prosper. Why did you bless me? But see, it's not about do you have the next thing the Joneses have. It's are you content with what you have? Is God not taking care of you? Are you begging for bread? No, God is taking care of you individually. And then, as you look at the rest of the story, God tells them, now, I don't want to give you too much. So what I want you to do is I want you to take the bread daily. You remember the prayer of Jesus when they said, Lord, teach us how to pray. He says, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day. See, the problem is we're looking for next week. We pre-planning for next year. But I recall James says, what is your life? It's but a vapor that appears for a moment then vanishes away. James says, don't say what I'm going to do on tomorrow, because you might not be here tomorrow. As Brother Howard said this afternoon, we had a lot of deaths in our community. I know of 4 people that have lost their mother in the last 2 months. I know a young lady who was 31 years old. She had a stroke. She got over the stroke, went to Grady to get a medicine, was in the bathroom, didn't come out for about an hour. They went in, she was dead of a heart attack. What is your life? What is your life? God wants you to take daily bread. God doesn't want you to worry about Tuesday on Sunday. He doesn't even want you to worry about tomorrow on Sunday. Worry about today. He's feeding them day by day. And he just gives them enough. But just like us, you know how it is. When we get God's blessings, God says, I'm going to bless you. And some of them said, he said, now just take enough. What they do, they take more than enough. Yeah. I don't know about Jacob over there. You know, Jacob kind of eat a lot. Let me go ahead and grab mine now. They bring it in the house. The next morning, got worms and it starts to smell. Why? Because you didn't obey. You didn't obey. I told you to take enough. Do you not? See, the thing about it is, when you don't follow God's commands, it's like calling God a liar.
Yeah, that's right.
The book of Hebrews says, by two immutable things, it is impossible for God to lie. Right. When God says, I'm going to meet your daily needs, it's a done deal. Right. I got more confidence in God than my check on Friday.
All right.
You see what I'm saying? Because I know God ain't going to lie to me. A Bank of America might raise their fees. They might cancel my bank account because of insufficient funds. You know, I can't punch in $5 on that thing no more. I mean, I don't know. But I know God is good for it. I put my trust in Him. And so they tried to haul the manna, and they didn't know what it was. The word manna literally means what is it. They didn't know what it was, but they wanted a lot of it. And then once God says, okay, see, Moses, I told you, I'm testing him. He says, now tell him again. Now, if they want double portions, they get double portions on Friday. You take enough per day, but because I know I'm working on Saturday, they can take a double portion on Friday and they can prepare it for Saturday because the Sabbath they were not supposed to do any work. So what did some of them do? Saturday comes, they yawn, oh, man, it's the Sabbath already. I was just pulling the barn the other day. I mean, oh yes, the manna today. He is the Sabbath. He said, I'll go out. He said, oh man, ain't no, God said, look at this. Just told y'all, don't go out your house, and the first thing you do is go out your house. Isn't that man? Man will do that every time. God will say, do it this way. Man will say, you know what? But what if? God will say, he that believes that is baptized shall be saved. Man says, well, what about if I just believe? Man says, there's one time we can once save, always save. God says, uh-uh. You can fall for grace. Man says, you know what? I want a female preacher because I'm tired of all these men preachers. They just as good as God says, no. It's something I want to usurp the authority. Man always wants to get over on God some kind of way, doesn't he?
But then he says, don't go out on the Sabbath. And they still go out on the Sabbath. God, remember this, write this down. God gives you just enough to make it that day. Some of y'all are living paycheck to paycheck. But can I tell you something? You're still living. See, the problem with them and the problem is with us, they forgot something. They forgot they were sojourners, not settlers. Think about it. See, this wasn't like this. They weren't packing it up. And oh, man, they were like this. Good to see you. Uh-huh. Yeah. Oh, now we ain't going to be here very long. We're going to keep on moving. But after a while, they forgot that fact. See, you're not going to stay in Shura all your life. You're not going to stay in sin all your life. You're not going to stay in Edom all your life. You know why? Because your goal is Canaan. So I'm going to give you enough to go from here to here to here to here. And you can see that in your own lives. You've seen where God has taken you from point A to point B to point C. You know, first, you know, you had no education. Then you got a little education. Then you went back to get some more education. Then you got married. Then you got your wife and kids. Now you're settling down. God is taking you through stages in your life. That's what he's doing. He's preparing you for something better. King David, perfect example. King David didn't start off as King David. King David was a, what? Shepherd. Fooling with dirty, stupid sheep. Brothers out there fighting. Hey, man, y'all gonna bring me back some? Shut up, David. Oh, I'm tending them sheep. Then all of a sudden, he was a musician. You know, David face too. Hey, Doc, it's good to hear you. Y'all need more music? I got it right here. But all that was preparing him to be king. See, you got to decrease so God can increase. You got to learn that particular thing in your life. But as we come to the close, I want you to see something here. As they were traversing through the various wildernesses, they stopped in a place where God was feeding them, but they forgot again that this was not their last stopping point. God was taking them through these places, but he says, as good as Edom was, 12 wells, 70 palm trees, all the food and cheese you can eat, it wasn't Canaan. It wasn't the land of milk and honey. As nice as the waters were in Marah after they were made sweet, it didn't have pomegranates and grapes. You see, sometimes you have to realize that your stopping ground is not your permanent residence. In conclusion, we have to realize that God is taking care of us now. Paul said it like this in Philippians chapter 4, verse 11. He says, not that I speak in respect of want, for I have learned in whatsoever state I am, therewith to be content. I wish somebody would realize this world is not our home. I'm just passing through. My treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the blue. And someone here this evening may not be a member of the Lord's church. Somebody is asking that burning question like those 3,000 plus men did in the day of Pentecost. Men and brethren, what shall I do to be saved? See, you can't partake of the promised land unless you're part of a chosen people. Lord has set up a plan. It's not a man-made plan. It's a God-derived plan. I can't change it because God said what's settled in heaven is settled on earth. And so you can't change it. I can't change it. The only one that can change it is the one that has the authority. And when he comes back, he's already got the plan. He said, I'm coming back for a church. He didn't say, I'm coming back for these churches. I'm coming back for a church. Which one is that church? Now, I don't want you to think about the building right now. I don't want you to get all, you know, mixed up about this. This ain't my church. I go to New Devil or Rock of Faith. Hope International. Don't get it confused. We're not talking about a building right now. We're talking about a called out assembly. We're talking about a group of people that have obeyed the same rule, and as a result, they get the same benefit. See, I can't work for the company I work for
and be blessed by Coca-Cola, because I don't work for Coca-Cola. One of the most powerful analogies, Dr. Washington said this years ago, he said it was about a man who needed a job. He was so desperate to feed his family, he said, man, I'll take any job. I'll take any job. He saw a man's backyard that had been overrun with weeds. And he said, well, I'll tell you what, let me do this. I'm going to go to that man's house. Got a lawnmower in the back. He knocked on the front door. He said, sir, listen, I have 3 kids to take care of. I'll take any job at this point. Would you mind if I mowed your lawn and took care of you? Because I see you got all this overgrowth, and I'm pretty handy. I can take care of that. The man looked at him and said, yeah, sure. He said, I'll pay you a fair wage. They agreed on the wage. The man went back there, worked from sun up to sundown, sweating, tired, muscles hurt. But he was proud of his results because he worked so diligently. He worked so hard. And he got the end result. He came back to the man and knocked on the door. The man came and said, you finished? He said, yeah. He said, I think you're going to like it. He said, I think you're going to like it. The man said, well, come, let me take a look. So he walked with the gentleman, and he went back to his yard. And he looked, and all he saw was weeds and overgrowth. Grass, knee high. And then he was about to turn around and look at the man. He saw across the way, he had a neighbor whose grass was neatly cut. The bushes were nicely pruned. And the man looked at the gentleman and said, he said, do you like it? He said, yeah. He said, well, he said, yeah, I kind of like it. So you did a good job. He said, good, I'm glad. I did my best. He said, yeah, that's only one problem. He said, you did it in another man's yard. He said, I can't pay you for cutting my neighbor's grass. I got to pay you for working in my field. If you die tonight, are you assured that you worked in God's field? Jesus says, many will say on that day, Lord, Lord, did not do this, did not cast out demons, did not do many wonderful works in your name. Did I go to T.D. Jakes, Woman Bow Wow Loose? Did I dance when the choir played the organ? Did I clap the loudest? Did I do backflips over the pews? But Lord, why you can't reward me? He says, depart from me, I never knew you. I never had a relationship with you because you didn't follow me. Paul says, unless a man strive lawfully, that's according to the law. He's disqualified. Lastly, let me leave you with this story, and I'll end here. There was a play called The Night at Sarah Mackin. There was, in this particular scene, a gentleman who went into the town to buy some supplies and provisions. And when he went into the store, death in this play was represented by a blonde-headed woman in a trench coat. And as she walked into the store, he looked up and he saw death. He got so nervous, he ran to the storekeeper. He said, listen, give me your freshest, fastest horse. He said, well, okay, no problem. He says, why? He said, I got to get out of here. He said, well, okay. He said, well, where you going? He says, I'm going to Summerbrand. He said, okay, right. So he takes the horse and he takes off. Later on that evening, the store clerk closes his store. And he's walking in the town square, and he sees the same lady with the trench coat. And he walks up to her, and he says, excuse me, your name is Death, right? She said, yes. He said, well, why did you scare one of my customers earlier today? She said, oh, I'm sorry, sir, I didn't mean to startle him. She said, because I was shocked as he was. He said, I was supposed to meet him later on tonight at San Marcan. See, you can't escape death. Death knows where you're going. And it'll be there before you get there. But then what are you going to do after this? It's not about trying to scare you into being saved. But I want you to think on your soul's salvation. And you can be in the faith and still not be sure. You know your life better than anybody else does. Don't fool yourself by not coming down to getting it right with God. Now, if you're not a member of the Lord's church, you need to hear that Jesus Christ suffered and died on the cross for you and I. Once you hear that, you must believe that to be true. You must confess the sweetest name of mortal tongue, that Jesus Christ is Lord, and then he can be your Savior. Repent, change your mind, and go down into the watery grave of baptism. Don't ask any questions. Why not to be? Just do it. Just do it. Go down into the watery grave of baptism. Mark 16, 15 and 16. He that believeth that is baptized shall be saved. He that believeth not shall be damned. That's strong enough for me.
Amen.
I can question God when I get to heaven. But until then, he set the rules. If you're amenable to any of these, we want you to stand right now, stand on your feet, and come back as we sing the Lord's invitation.